डायबिटिक ऑटोनोमिक न्यूरोपैथी। आई एम थैंकफुल टू डॉक्टर बंसी साबू सर फॉर एकोमोडेटिंग मी इन सेंट्रल इंडिया सिंपोजियम विद माय डियर ब्रदर्स डॉक्टर भरत एंड डॉक्टर आशीष। एंड टुडे माय टॉपिक इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट एंड लेस नोन टॉपिक एंड आई विल बी ट्राइंग टू जस्टिफाई दिस टॉपिक इन एज वाइज वर्ड्स एज आई कैन। माय स्लाइड्स आर विजिबल टू यू? My slides are visible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Visible,
yes,
doctor.
Yes, sir. So this, here in an autonomic neuropathy, we all know that we are having a Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh type of presentation and control in our body system. And Brahma is our central nervous system. Vishnu is our autonomic nervous system with Mahesh and autonomic sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. And these all systems control our body so happily and in so such a pendular balance that everything is in perfect orchestra. So with this orchestra and with this background, how this system works and how we get involved in diabetics, why autonomic neuropathy happens, what are the pathophysiology and how they work. So here comes the autonomic nervous system. We have like in center we have a central government, and in states we have state governments. Here lies a system which definitely gives you a simple example that how they work. They work like that. Member of parliaments is like sympathetic nervous system, and MLAs are like the parasympathetic nervous system. Sympathetic nervous system activates body. They have a thoracolumbar ganglion, short preganglionic and long postganglionic fibers with global responses. They have mainly a transmitter like norepinephrine, where in parasympathetic nervous system, we have a craniosacral ganglions. They have long preganglionic and short postganglionic fibers. They are very close to the organ, short postganglionic fiber, and postganglionic transmitter is most of the time acetylcholine. That's why vagus nerve is most of the time associated with parasympathetic nervous system. And a sympathetic nervous system is a fight flight system. It activates, increases heart rate, have increased sweating, dilates pupil, inhibits GI movement, closes a sphincter. Ejaculation is through that, diverts blood from skin and GI tract. It acts as a fight flight. It acts on emergency. And what parasympathetic does, it's a rest digest system. So it's a perfect balance between both. Promotes digestion, GI peristalsis, slows heart rate, constricts pupil, empties bladder, relaxes sphincter, mediates genital erection. But ejaculation is from sympathetic nervous system. What happens and what is diabetic autonomic neuropathy? It's the least recognized, least understood complications of diabetes and can have significant negative impact because it increases cost of caring too much. And the all things are unpredictable when patients land in diabetic autonomic neuropathy. There is widespread damage, peripheral and autonomic nerves are involved, small vessels are involved. And what happens that it impairs our metabolic functions of glucose counter regulation. So diabetes becomes brittle and its unexpected outcomes can happen. And it's why it's important to recognize, because 25 to 50% of these patients die within the 5 to 10 years of diagnosis, and 5-year mortality rate is very, very high. Marker of adverse cardiovascular, renal and cerebrovascular outcome is the neuropathy. And what is the mechanism? We all know that all diabetic, that pathophysiology of all diabetic complications is underlined by same advanced glycated end products. There are structural components changes. There are changes in Schwann cell, endothelium, matrix protein, fibronectin, and there is non-enzymatic glycation through various pathway, oxidative stress, polyol pathway, and consequence of neuropathic changes in autonomic ganglions and then postganglionic fibers and all. That's why what transmission should done from the central nervous system is not taken care of properly, and there is local deconstruction regarding the PNS and SNS system when it happens. And what happens when diabetic autonomic neuropathy happens? 75% of all our parasympathetic activities taken care by vagus nerve, which is the earliest nerve to be get affected. And when it get affects, it affects our systems, and single system can be affected or multiple systems can be affected at that time. And according to the symptoms, we systems involved, we can have symptoms. Like if pupillary involvement is there, then there is decreased diameter and dark adaptation, meiosis, ARP, pupil, cardiovascular, we have cardiac denervation, resting tachycardia, orthostatic hypotension, prolonged QT interval, neurovascular, then we have hyperhidrosis, changes in skin flow, gastrointestinal, genitourinary, and respiratory. I'm going to deal with gastro, cardiac, and genito, which is my topic of the day today. So cardiac autonomic neuropathy in its early stage, when it's in early stage, it can be completely asymptomatic or can have only heart rate variability in deep breathing. But when it comes to the advanced stage, then there develops orthostatic hypotension, and their clinical impairment can occur and it can be detrimental. Sometimes
Dr. Raka, there is some audio issues.
Hypotension still itself has a deadly complications. This is the natural progression of cardiac autonomic neuropathy. You initially have parasympathetic denervation, which is subclinical stage where you have only heart rate or RR variation, which can be very well tackled in CANS automatic machine, which we have today in our clinics, from which we can deduce these kind of parameters. And when they have a sympathetic tone augmentance, there is the early stages of clinical cardiac autonomic neuropathy. You have resting tachycardia, reduced exercise tolerance. Then you have sympathetic denervation, which is at an advanced stage, and patient land up in orthostatic hypotension because all sympathetic nerves, which helps in flight fright system, they have been denerved. So diagnostic assessment of cardiovascular autonomic tone, we have simple assessment through CARTS. These are called cardiovascular autonomic reflex tests, and these are the gold standard tests because they can be reproduced, they can be repeatedly checked, and they are based on heart rate and BP monitoring and ambulatory BP monitoring. And evolution of CAN can't be any having a singular approach. We have some approach to parasympathetic system. For sympathetic system, parasympathetic system, we have a heart rate response to breathing, standing, and Valsalva maneuver, where we can calculate Valsalva ratio, and sympathetic BP response to standing and isometric exercise. How it can be done? Here is a graph which I have given you to just have a brief outlook, because these tests should be done in proper labs where we have all kind of these design parameters so that we can calculate automatically, or we need to go for every kind of mathematical calculations. Testing and reflexly parasympathetic nervous system by Valsalva ratio. In normally, it should be greater than 1.2, but when it's less than 1.1, it's abnormal. If you have RR inter variation, it should be normal is more than 15 beats per minute. This is 30 to 15 minute ratio, which is calculated by longest RR interval and shortest RR interval, 30th beat and 50th beat. And if you talk about blood pressure, that is sympathetic function monitoring, you have blood pressure response to standing, which where is the fall in systolic blood pressure is less than 10 is normal. And with isometric hand grip, an increase in diastolic blood pressure of more than 16 millimeter of mercury is normal. Anything above or lower than that should be taken as normal. This is the test report, and this is the FT lab where we used to treat and take our patients, and these are calibrated by all kind of curves and all. And there we have postural hypotension, sustained hand grip, and this is sympathetic parameter, and here is the parasympathetic parameter, which is resting heart rate and standing in Valsalva manner. So here is the Toronto consensus panel on diabetic neuropathy, and they have class 2, class 2A, and class 3, and class 4 indications, and they have tested and given a reference that CART tests are the gold standard, and heart rate response to deep breathing, standing, and Valsalva maneuver, or BP response to standing, is class 2 evidence because they are sensitive, specific, reproducible, and easy to carry out. Valsalva maneuver should not be advisable in presence of proliferative retinopathy because it can harm. CART are subject to number of confounding or interfering factors. Age is the most relevant factor affecting heart rate, and definitive diagnosis of CAN and CAN staging requires more than one heart rate test and the orthostatic hypotension. So we all know, I have given you the brief in at the earliest also, that orthostatic hypotension terms to the more severely and advanced patient and symptomatic patient. And there, this is the really cascade of how the stages of this cardiac autonomic disease goes from possibly early to definite confirm to severely symptomatic. Now comes gastrointestinal neuropathy. Gastrointestinal neuropathy may involve any portion of the gastrointestinal tract due to esophageal dysmotility, gastroparesis, constipation, diarrhea, fecal incontinence. And to our response, if we probe our patient, most of our patients are suffering from these things. And gastroparesis should not be suspected in the individuals with erratic glucose control or with upper GI symptoms without any another identified cause. And what is the pathophysiology? The all fundus and all part of gastrointestinal tract is well innervated, and they act as a combined defined machinery. And there is, if any kind of dysmotility, reduced ileus tone, GERD, delayed gastric emptying, decrease in intestinal transit time, increase in colonic transit time, all this happens. There's changes in gut microbiota, there's defective and enteral mixing, and everything gets changes, and there's gastric dysrhythmia. It behaves like a GI heart, and there comes all kind of complications of gastric autonomic neuropathy. Evaluation of gastric emptying should be done according to gastric emptying breath test or double isotope scintigraphy. Constipation is the most common symptom. Gastroparesis should be suspected in patients with nausea, vomiting, and early satiety. The goal of evaluation is to exclude any kind of mechanical obstruction and establish the diagnosis. So evaluation of gastroparesis, there should be always an exclusion criteria to mechanical obstruction, and there should be a combined approach. So from the gastroenterologist, there should be a CT enterography or MRI enterography to exclude mechanical obstruction, and CTMR, and whatever approach we can take as a combined view, because it's autonomic neuropathy with gastric complications, it should be handled as a combined total team. And scintigraphic gastric emptying is the most cost effective, simple, and widely available technique to confirm the presence of delayed gastric emptying. Evaluation of gastroparesis, pre-test instructions are that medications that affect gastric emptying should be stopped. Based on pharmacokinetics of the medication, the need to be stopped more than 48 hours of testing. Patients with diabetes should have glucose measured before starting and after starting, and their sugar should be less than 2. And these are the additional tests, D-xylose test for small intestine and malabsorption. You have all kind of blood biochemistry. If you take a first line investigation, then second line investigation are upper GI endoscopy, colonoscopy, and glucose hydrogen breath test. Third line is ambulatory small intestinal manometry for intestinal pseudo-obstruction. So these autonomic neuropathy of GI tract are most of the time presentation in our patients, but we're neglecting. Sometimes we are not taking help of our own, different colleagues of different faculties. GIT urinary disturbance are another more big pass picture, which we used to neglect as a physician. In men, diabetic autonomic neuropathy may cause erectile dysfunction or retrograde ejaculation. And here we have one topic on ED also, which Dr. Ashish will take. So I'll not take more of that. Evaluation of bladder function should be performed in individuals with diabetes who have recurrent urinary tract infections. Differential diagnosis of diabetic neuropathy, we all know that these kind of systemic presentation can have different cause also, and we need to rule out these kind of complications along with that, because of high degree of clinical suspicions is needed, and any kind of presentation should not be taken as just in cause of autonomic neuropathy, because we know less about that. Prevention of diabetic neuropathy is focused on lifestyle modification and tight glucose control, and early optimization of glucose control in patients with type 1 diabetes, a class 1A indications, and a multifactorial approach, multidisciplinary approach should be taken. Treatment of diabetic neuropathy, implementation of tight glucose control remains the key, lifestyle modification, reducing insulin resistance, intensive glycemic control, and there should be a proper treatment protocol in case of severe cases of orthostatic hypotension, because they are very, very severe, and they land up in high degree of mortality. These are the molecules which we can use, like fluorohydrocortisone, sympathetic agents, ephedrine, pseudoephedrine, phenylephrine, alpha agonist, amiodarone, clonidine, amlodipine octreotide, and they all have certain diagnostic tests to give this. There are certain doses which should be properly, and side effect profile of each molecule should be taken into consideration before prescribing, and multi-faculty approach and multi-systemic approach should be taken. Diagnostic and treatment of diabetic gastroparesis, here is the drug where we can use metacromide, erythromycin, domperidone, bethanecol, leucelpride, botulinum toxin and all. Side effect profile should be taken into consideration. Diabetic diarrhea is very much common. Here we have some presentations and sensation test of anus, rectal examination of sphincter muscles, endoscopic examination of GIT, 72 hour stool examination test of pancreatic enzyme function. And here are the drugs which are used sometimes by our own physician friend and sometimes our gastro friend. And we need to go to side effect profile very, very in scrutiny wise. And then these drugs, then this treatment should be started. Cystopathy, the diabetic cystopathy, bladder dysfunction is very, very much common. And we have different kind of bladder presentation. And here are the drugs which are used as a and diagnostic tests are cystometrogram, post-voiding sonography. Friends, it's a wide topic, less understood topic. There is so much to talk about, but in only 13 minutes, it's not justified to give every kind of purview of this this topic. And erectile dysfunction is also in presentation on genitourinary neuropathy, and sildenafil, verdenafil, tadalafil are tried, and they have their own side effect profile. So key take-home message from diabetic autonomic neuropathy is classified as a subclinical depending upon the presence and absence of symptoms. It can be clinical. It can be having several detrimental presentation. Wide spectrum of symptoms can affect many different organs, including the cardiovascular, genitourinary, pupillary, pseudomotor, and neuroendocrine system. Unfortunately, it is often recognized too late, and then it can have a serious consequences of patient health and even life. With the help of simple cardiovascular autonomic tests, autonomic neuropathy can be diagnosed, and these reproducible tests should be performed whenever we diagnose.